Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Jack Dailey, director of the Smithsonian's National Air and Space Museum, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to the 2011 Charles A. Lindbergh Lecture. You probably wonder about that date, right? The Lindbergh Lecture is an annual tradition in May here in the museum. Since 1982, the program has featured pioneers who represent the special qualities associated with Charles Lindbergh: skill, determination, imagination, courage, and vision. Charles Lindbergh completed his history-making nonstop solo flight from New York to Paris on May 21st, 1927. This evening's program is made possible by Bombardier. With us tonight is Ms. Alain Gagnon, who is the Vice President for Public Affairs, Communications, and Corporate Social Responsibility at Bombardier Aerospace. Alain, would you stand and be recognized? Thank you. It's important to point out that without sponsorship, none of these programs would be available, so we are indebted to Bombardier for making this evening possible. Thank you, Alain. Our theme for all of this year's lectures has been the Centennial of Marine Aviation. Each year we go through an extensive process to identify a distinguished member of the aviation community to share his or her vision, memories, and insights. We are guided in this process by the museum's mission, which is to commemorate, educate, and inspire. Tonight we'll hear from a Marine fighter pilot as he reflects on the first 100 years of Marine aviation. We are honored to welcome Senator John Glenn as the 2012 Charles A. Lindbergh Lecturer. Senator Glenn exemplifies the museum's guiding principles through a lifetime of achievements that span seven decades. He truly is a legend in his own time. I normally introduce speakers with a great deal of detail about their past, but we're not going to do that tonight because we're going to be talking about his past. And besides, you probably all know more about his life than any other speaker we've ever had in here. So, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Senator John Glenn. I know. Well, I was going to try that.
I thank Jack for the promotion.
My favorite title for him is Payload Specialist. As we've said, we're going to focus tonight on the Centennial of Marine Aviation, and because it's a long span of time to cover and a lot of information, we've picked certain points of it, but we are going to cover all aspects from 1912 on. And to set the stage, Senator, would you like to reflect a little bit on your thoughts about the very early days and up until pre-World War I?
I would indeed, and thank you, and welcome everyone, and appreciate you being here tonight, and we'll have a time for, we hope, at the end of this for Q&A, so if you have questions where you want to contribute either a comment or a question, why, that'll be fine also. I think every time I come down here at the Air and Space Museum, I'm impressed with how far aviation came in a very short period of time. If you think about the pace of advance, this whole thing started in 1903. And I don't know how many of you have been up and looked at the Wright brothers' airplane up there, but if you look at that and look how they controlled the airplane even, where they were, he was lying on the wing, but he moved his hips back and forth to control the right and left flight of the plane. And that was hooked onto a wire that went up on each side and bent the wing down to give more lift or less lift. Now, wouldn't a 747 pilot today love to have that method of... You can see this wig-wagging coming in on a 747, but they soon got beyond that. And it was in 1915, just about 12 years later, that we had the had airplanes over there in World War II that were flying combat flights over there and all sorts of maneuvers and so on, and that happened in a very, very short period of time. It was just about 24 years up to 1927. And as General Dailey said, the Lindbergh flew across the Atlantic in 1927. And it was just 66 years until Neil Armstrong landed on the moon. What a progression we made in a very, very short period of time. In 1912 is when Alfred Cunningham became the first Marine pilot. And that was it was quite a milestone in the Marine Corps. Everybody was not for it. There were some objections to it. Some thought, what use could this new idea of flying have to do with it? And they didn't really get in on World War I. They missed that a little bit, although Marines were in World War I, and you remember they were involved in Belleau Wood in particularly, and out of that they were notable in their performance there. The Germans actually referred to them as Teufelhunde, which means devil dogs. And that's where the Marine title of devil dogs came from, was from their performance there. But that was not part of the air ground team at that time. This new concept came in to add to the uniqueness of the Corps that started back in 1775. Marines have been trained for very special amphibious activities and had been termed as sea soldiers or seaborne infantry, whatever at that time. And they'd been on many, many different places where the president had called upon them to go in and represent this country in either protecting the country's interests or protecting American lives and property. And and those are celebrated even in the Marine hymn, from the halls of Montezuma to the shores of Tripoli and all the places in between where Marines had actually performed. So it was a ready force even back in those days, and it was, but for limited missions. It wasn't for all-out war and anything like a world war. But it was brought forth a new concept of an air ground team. And in the Marine Corps, that really was developed between World War I and World War II in what have been termed the Banana Wars. And the other services were not involved with this, but it was in those Banana Wars that the Marine Corps really got started on its mission of an air ground team and close air support. And the Banana Wars were in Haiti and the Dominican Republic and Nicaragua. And the first two of those, Marine aviation was used mainly for reconnaissance and supply and medical use and so on. But in Nicaragua, the Marines on the ground were hard pressed in some of the things. And for the first time, Marine aviation came in and really helped by dropping bombs and by firing machine guns and so on, help the troops on the ground. And that really was the very first time that close support had been carried to that kind of level. Bombs had been dropped before, but this kind of close support, this beginning of an air ground team, had been used there for the first time. Now Cunningham, who was the first Marine aviator, had put it well, I think, in an earlier thing that he wrote, where he said, "The only excuse for aviation in any service is its usefulness in assisting the troops on the ground to successfully carry out their mission." And I think he was right. And that that has been true in the Marine Corps ever since. All the elements of supporting arms are in one ready force in the Marine Corps, and that includes aviation. Ready to go. Aviation air ground team rounds that out. And that brings us up to World War II days and is sort of a preface to what I and my colleagues of those days in the early World War II days when we were being trained. It was sort of the legacy behind us that gave us a start in our own careers in aviation. And my career in aviation had that as its background. And we used that then overseas and developed the concept even further in World War II and in Korea. So that's how we sort of got to where we are at World War II days.
And World War II was where you were ready to start to play.
Yeah.
I think it's important that we define one term before we go any further. Your good friend, Lieutenant General Tom Miller, used to refer to you as a sniveler. And that's a term that can be both positive and negative. And if you look it up in the dictionary, you won't find it, because it's a Marine Corps aviation term, but everybody knows what it means, because a sniveler is somebody who is trying to get a good deal or a better deal than everybody else by either being available for a flight or getting a flight or being prepared for a flight. And so it's a person who's always hustling is another term for that. And we may see some of that as we go through the rest of this evening.
Sniffling is a bad term. I look at it as selective opportunity.
It's just like a call sign. You don't ever get to give your own. We give it to you. But sniffler will be the term we use tonight. you had your pilot license before entering the service, and you came in through the Naval Aviation Cadet program. Would you kind of describe that process and then also talk about a plan that you had during flight training to set yourself up for the future?
Sniveling again. Sniveling, I know what you're talking about. Well, when Pearl Harbor occurred, as a matter of fact, my wife Annie was an organist. She was in college and had an organ recital on a Sunday afternoon, which was required as part of her training. And she was very good at this, and I was driving up to her organ recital when I heard on the radio that Pearl Harbor had occurred. Well, I had gone through some flight training earlier that year. I saw on the bulletin board one day a thing that you could get your private pilot's license at government expense, and they would pay all the bills for it, and you get your private pilot's license. Well, I thought that was too good to miss. And so I went in and signed up for that. And so early in 1941, I had my private pilot's license. And then in December 41, of course, was Pearl Harbor. And I felt it was my duty then to leave and go into military training, which I did. And Annie and I had planned to be married after we were out of college, and we had to postpone that, of course, while I was in flight training. But it was that that led me into flight training, and I was it was called the V-5 program back then, Naval Aviation Cadet Program. And you went directly into to flight training, and about halfway through training, or through advanced training, if you wanted to, you could request your commission be granted not in the Navy, which you was training you at that time, but that you get your commission in the Marine Corps, and I applied for that. I wanted to be in the Marine Corps. And so that's how I got to where I was. And the, what was the other part of your question you asked?
There was a rumor going around at that time that the Marines were gonna get P-38s. Oh,
yeah. I had it in mind, I wanted to be a fighter pilot. Now you have to remember back in those days, there were not cell phones and easy communication back and forth. And when we were halfway through advance and I had been selected to go in the Marine Corps, the rumor went around that the Marine Corps was going to get P-38s. Now the P-38 was one of the finest airplanes that came out in the early part of World War II, and was one of the best fighters. And that the rumor was that those who had twin engine experience in training were going to be able to get P-38s and fly fighters after that. Now, I don't know whether we have the pictures of those up there or not, but Tom Miller and I, as Jack mentioned, Tom and I went over, both of us wanted to be in fighters, and we thought we needed to get twin engine experience, and the only twin engine was the old PBY flying boat. And so in advanced training, although I sort of hate to admit it to this day, but we went through our advanced training, landing and doing all the things you do in a PBY in training, and graduated with that in our background. I was transferred to Cherry Point, North Carolina, expecting to see my big P-38 sitting on the line. And of course, the Marine Corps had never heard of P-38s. So I was assigned out to the West Coast at that time and went out there. It was in a transport squadron, but being trained there, but managed to get transferred to an F-4F squadron, a fighter squadron that was right on the other side of the field.
Wait, I'm making that a little too easy. Okay, you were trained in multi-engine, you were a transport pilot, and you wanted to be a fighter pilot. You were on one side of the field, you saw the fighter group on the other side, and then how did you work this?
I should say this is classified information, but I won't. Well, Tom and I, being brand new Marines, we were a little bit low on how you do things at that time and the channels you need to go through. We went over to the other side of the field where this Marine Fighter Squadron was and talked to the people over there and the skipper over there, whose name was Pete Haynes. And we talked to him and that we'd like to get transferred. And he said, well, he needed a couple of additional pilots. And if we could get transferred, well, that would be fine. So we went back over and to our own side of the field. And we were called, about a few hours later, we were called into the group commanding officer, a colonel. And it was like something out of a movie. He stood us in front of his desk at attention, and he got up and walked around chewing us out like you never got in your life for bypassing channels and trying to get transferred out of his outfit without him knowing about it. But a couple of days later, the transfer did come through. And so we were in this fighter squadron that then flying F-4Fs, got transferred to El Centro, California for our final training. But the final training was to be in the F-4U, the Corsair, which was to replace the F-4Fs. Now, the F-4F you may remember as the plane that Joe Foss and Marion Carl and the other people flew at Guadalcanal, which was a real air superiority requirement for that F-4F. But it was not a good air superiority airplane, didn't have that kind of performance. But just by cooperation and coordination between pilots, they did an amazing job at the F-4F at Guadalcanal. We knew that the F-4U, the Corsair, was coming down the line, and when we got to El Centro, we had the first version of that airplane, which had been one that the Navy had a lot of trouble with. The F-4U was originally designed as a Navy aircraft, carrier aircraft, and it was to but it had a lot of problems, had some aerodynamic problems for coming aboard ship, and enough difficulties that the Navy then didn't want to use it aboard ship, and so the Marines sort of inherited it for land-based use, which was fine, and the problems were being worked on. And that was where we trained then in the first of the F-4Us that still had some of these problems being worked out. And we were at and got those, the new version of the airplane, it was much improved, and that the Navy did use some later on, that was a much improved version that we did our final training in, and then went overseas with that. It was a good airplane. I think it was the best fighter airplane of World War II. It was almost identical in performance to the P-51, but of course the F-4U Corsair was one that had to operate aboard ship, and so it had a tail hook, but it still had the performance. It had the first of our really big, reliable 2,000 horsepower engines. I remember the first time I ever flew that, I thought there'd never be any engine any more powerful than that as long as I lived. But it was a R2800 2,000 horsepower engine on a little airplane like that. And that was something that was very unusual back then.
When you had the initial version of the F-4U, there was, as the problems that the Navy was having, Charles Lindbergh actually took a modified Corsair, yeah, and was going to go around the fleet to introduce it and to show what was coming. And that's where you met him, at El Centro. You want to tell about another opportunity for you to gain...
You're back to sniveling again, aren't you? No, Lindbergh had been hired by, I think it was United Aircraft at that time, to give them some advice on some of the things that they were working on, and one of them was the Corsair. And so he had flown the airplane, and when they got the improved version of it, he flew around to different squadrons all over the country, demonstrating it and pointing out how the improvements had been made and what a much better airplane it was now. Our squadron in El Centro was one of the ones that he came to. And so this was an F-4U-1D, as it was called, had a big bubble canopy on it that was much improved. Some of the aerodynamics of the uneven stall had been corrected, had a raised tail wheel and some things like that, made it a much better airplane. When he came there, Tom Miller and I, we bypassing the normal procedures, we went down to the flight line where he was with his airplane to meet him, and met him and talked to him a little bit and asked if we could fly his airplane, which he was happy to have people fly in this new version. And so Tom and I both got to fly fly that airplane at that time. We didn't know, but we would see him later on in the war overseas when he was making an overseas tour and stopped at our squadron there and flew a couple of combat missions with us overseas.
But you were a couple of lieutenants. You went over and found him in base ops, and you talked him into letting you fly his airplane. Nobody knew you were going to do it. Did anybody talk to you about that afterwards?
Just our squadron CO.
You were learning more and more about the Marine Corps. Yeah,
Tom and I learned how to go through channels after that.
I'm not sure. Your squadron deployed from there overseas.
Yeah.
And the nation was mobilizing. Our ships were coming online and all sorts of ways to get to war. How did you actually get to war?
We headed to war in a converted banana boat. True story. The USS Santa Monica, prior to the war, had been plying up and down the Pacific, bringing bananas up. And they had these big holds that were huge holds where they used to put the bananas. And when the war broke out, they converted that boat, so they put decks in there and put bunks in there. And that's what we went overseas on from San Francisco to Hawaii, not on out farther than that. But it was quite a ship. I think I took my blanket up on deck the first night and stayed there and didn't. I don't think I slept down below decks on all the trip out to Hawaii, which was a number of days, of course. But that's how we got there. But there had been, beyond that, there had been some delay in going into the Marshall Islands. The Marshall Islands had been used by the Japanese to really, they'd fortified them, they'd put a lot of people and equipment there, and they were going to use that as basis for further activity and further expansion of the war. The idea in going into the Marshalls was that we would go in there, and these islands that the Japanese were threatening to come back and retake and use as new bases. And they kept sending out propaganda that this was just about to happen. Our job was to keep these bypassed islands knocked down to where that could never happen. The difficulty wasn't just that they were bypassed, it was that they had left a lot of people and equipment, tremendous amounts of anti-aircraft fire, for instance, anti-aircraft equipment on those islands. And so every mission that we went on out there, we had a lot of anti-aircraft fire. But we were delayed in getting there. We went, since the invasion had been delayed somewhat, they sent us out to Midway for about a month's extra training out there, and then came back to Hawaii and went down on one of the small carriers to Majuro, which was we were supposed to be the first squadron to go into Majuro after it had been taken. And we were. I think one of the things I remember about that a little bit is, I don't know how many of you here are former Navy pilots, have catapulted a number of times, but when we went down there, the ship pulled into the lagoon and anchored. And the next day when we were to go ashore, I thought we probably were going back out of sea and be catapulted off. Instead of that, there was a little breeze blowing, and so the carrier was into the wind. They decided they'd just turn up the force on the catapult, and so we catapulted at anchor. And it was the first catapult any of us in the squadron had ever done. So, it all worked okay, and everybody got ashore all right.
You want to talk about what the Japanese concept was for the Marshals and what you were faced with in terms of the mission that you were given and the threat?
Yeah, the mission we were given was to, as I mentioned, was to keep them knocked down. And they had anti-aircraft fire to spare. And I don't think we ever flew a single mission we didn't see quite a lot of anti-aircraft fire. That came home on the very first flight we ever went on. Monty Goodman was one of my closest friends, was my wingman. We had trained together, flown together a lot. And on the very first flight, and out after you make a pass across the island and make your attack, you then pull up and go out to a rendezvous point before you head back home again to make sure everybody's there. Well, Monty didn't show up. And all we ever found of him was an oil slick in the water back about a mile off the island. So war making got to be very, very personal from that point on. It's very difficult to write letters to as many of you know, I'm sure, to write letters to next of kin and get those personal effects assembled to send back, and that happened on the very first mission we ever had out there. But we used bombs and rockets, guns, napalm, and our squadron was one of the ones that used the Corsair for dive bombing, which was a little unusual for a fighter. But when you put the landing gear down, it had big plates out there about that broad on the leading edge of the landing gear as they came down, and they served as speed restrictors, so that you could as dive brakes, so you could come in at a very steep angle, and we did a lot of the experimenting with that out there in the Marshall Islands. So while we're there too, we saw Lindbergh again, and that he came out and was making rounds of some of the squadrons at that time to see how things were going with the new Corsairs. And he flew a couple of missions with us out there before he moved on to visit another squadron.
Your squadron actually completed a year total, yeah. I guess, out there in the Marshalls. Mm-hmm. And then upon completion of that, you returned to the U.S. and were assigned to Pax River, not as a test pilot this time, but as a an aircraft exerciser of type.
That'd be a good way to put it. They called us test pilots, but we had not been through test pilot training. And what they wanted to do was take some people recently back from combat, and they had a stable of new prop airplanes that were just being prepared for combat, and they wanted to put the service life of the airplane on just as fast as they possibly could. And there were planes like the F-8F, the Bearcat, a new improved version of the Corsair, the F-8U, the F-7F, which had two engines of 2,000 horsepower each. Small fighter plane with 4,000 horsepower on that one airplane. So, and what they wanted to do was put the service life on the airplane as fast as possible. So you were scheduled right around the clock. They had flights scheduled day and night right around the clock, and you had an 8-hour shift. And if your airplane was in commission, well, you flew out of the, you'd be scheduled for 2, 3, or 3.5 hour flights during that 8-hour period. They wanted to get the service life on the airplane just as fast as they possibly could. Well, while we're there, the war ended, and the squadron I'd been at the end of my 3 months assignment at Patuxent. I was scheduled to go back to a squadron at Cherry Point, North Carolina, to train, and this would be training for going to the invasion of Japan. But at that time, the war ended, and that ended the invasion efforts or training for it. I was sent to the West Coast and a squadron out there, and then on to China, where we were a Corsair squadron again flying. We were based just outside Peking, it was in Beijing now. We would fly a pattern across that part of China every day, a big grid pattern to look for broken bridges that had been blown up or road breaks or anything like that. Actually, there were very few of those, but we carried a full load of ammunition and bombs and so on, but never had to use them there. So it was a period, though, a very unsettling period in the Marine Corps, just post-war. And it was almost, by the time I got back from overseas, it was almost 2 years later in what was supposed to be a very short period of time. Annie and I had been married just after I got out of flight training and got my wings. And our daughter was born when I was overseas on that China trip, as a matter of fact. So Annie had some problems, some post-birth problems, and I went back on emergency leave for a short period of time, saw our daughter, and then the next time I saw her, she was a little toddler. So you put up with some family situations there. With separations that were one of the bad parts of the whole thing.
So that little short trip to China turned out to be 2 years?
2 years, that's right.
And, but in part of that was in Guam also?
Yeah, most of it was in Guam. About 7 months was in, about just over six and a half months was in China. And then we came out down through Tsingtao, Shanghai, waited there for a carrier to come pick us up, and that plan was changed, so we finally flew our planes out to Okinawa and then on down to Guam later on. So anyway, it was a very unsettling time period in the Marine Corps. But when I came back from that, though, I went into the training command at Corpus Christi, Texas. And I was in the instructor's advanced training unit, and the Air Force had a very similar instructor's training unit at their field out at Williams Air Force Base in Arizona, just east of Phoenix. And it was, I thought then that I would like to see how they trained their instructors and compare it with how we trained our instructors. And so I applied for this to be done. Here we go again.
Pay attention, folks. That's the story he's using there.
The good part for me was that while at Corpus Christi, all of our training was being done in prop planes, at Williams Air Force Base, they were training in jets. And so it was a trip out there to not only check training methods, but I got checked out in the P-80, the old Shooting Star, which was the first of the airplanes that was really manufactured and put into the Air Force in big numbers. So it was a time period where I had advanced then from props to jets and wanted to stay in jets as much as I possibly could. But when I left there, I was sent to Quantico to the Amphibious Warfare School Junior Course. And that was something in the Marine Corps that's part of this air ground team concept, that you have officers and your people are in schools together and study what the other supporting arm is. And so I was in the Amphibious Warfare School, then was kept there on the staff after that for a period of time. And then finally went to Korea at the end of that session at Quantico. Now the Korea, I was glad that I had the jet experience, the P-80 experience, because that let me go in and then into, I was looked at for a jet assignment once I got to Korea.
You may have overlooked just one other little item before you left the training command. To not only did you fly the P-80, but you had some time in the F-86.
Well, no, that occurred after I got to Quantico.
Well, okay, but it was before you got to Korea. It was all part of this plan.
I know what he's building up to.
Well, okay, he's now qualified in jets.
Okay, I'm qualified in jets.
But not the right one.
I get to Quantico, and the person who was the colonel had been in charge of the training group at Williams Air Force Base. I'd gotten to know him a little bit, Colonel Leon Gray. And meanwhile, he had been transferred up to Otis Air Force Base and was in charge of all the F-86 training up there. Well, the reason I contacted him again was I knew about in Korea, they kept one spot for a Marine pilot in each one of the Air Force fighter interceptor squadrons. Now, they were flying F-86s, which was the finest fighter in the air at that time, and that fighter was the one that was up against the MiGs up in MiG Alley, if some of you may remember reading about that, and where we'd set up, the F-86 would set up a screen to prevent MiGs from coming across and coming down and hitting our close support airplanes or doing opposition to our forces on the ground down further south in Korea, down toward the front lines. So this was a... I knew I was due to go to Korea very soon, and I hoped that when my Marine missions were done out there, I might be able to get assigned to one of these slots in an Air Force squadron and do air-to-air flying, which is what the objective was. Since Marines did not have equipment to do that, we had good, the F-9F Panther was a good airplane for close air support and ground support work, which we really refined to a fine degree there. But I wanted to go up, they kept this so that we'd have some Marine pilots would have air-to-air experience, air combat experience. And I wanted to be part of that. That's sort of the ultimate fighter pilot, is to be is air-to-air flying, where your skill is what you're putting up against somebody else. So I was able to talk to Leon Gray, and he got me checked out in F-86s before I left the States.
What was his comment that when you asked if you could do that?
You're being very penetrating tonight. He said, you know it's illegal, and I know it's illegal, but come on up and we'll see if we can work it out. And so I did. And so I had four or five flights in the F-86 before I ever went to Korea. Out there then we went into, I think that really this air ground team in the Marine Corps was developed to a finer level in Korea than it had ever been done before. And it was, even in World War II, with all the close support and all that, in Korea the lines had become sort of static for a while, and there would be attacks once in a while back and forth, and we'd be called on for support in those areas. But we worked closer into the front lines to our people on the ground than any of us had ever done before in any flying we had done. And they did this, what the usual procedure was, that they would either use a grenade or a mortar round that was white phosphorus. Willie Peter, it was called, WP. And they'd fire it out and try and hit the spot that they wanted us to hit with the airplanes, right on the enemy lines. And this would be either with machine guns or rockets or bombs or napalm, which is, I know the aversion to even thinking about napalm, but it was used, and it's a hideous weapon, but it works. And so we used that on some of them too. And the placement of exact, so you know exactly where you were to hit. It wasn't left up to a grid pattern or reading a map. You had something there on the ground. If their round did not come down on the exact target, they'd tell you it's 50 yards, 50 meters north of that is where they want you to hit. And so you came down on that. And so we really refined that a lot. And the F-4U and another airplane, the AD, which was an airplane that carried a little greater load, a considerably greater load of bombs than the Corsair did. And we would have things there for close air support, like the JOC flights, JOC flights they were called, Joint Operations Center flights, where you stood strip alert and you were loaded and the starters were all plugged in, and if you got a call to go help somebody up there on the lines, you were off within a minute or two with your two planes or four planes to go up there. At other times, if there was really a lot of action in the front, we'd do CAP flights, combat air patrol flights, where you were fully loaded with bombs, rockets, everything you might need. But those are you're behind the lines a little ways, just circling, waiting to be called. And if they had a problem on the ground and they would call, you could literally be on your run and into the target in a matter of minutes. And the people on the ground obviously loved that kind of close support. And I think it was through all the work we did up there that it was the close support, the air-ground team working together, ground and air, and with forward air controllers on the ground, which was something new out there then, to really help. And you may remember reading something about the Marine when they were surrounded at the Chosin Reservoir and had to come out. And some of those, the close support they were given there was one of the key factors in helping them get out. So this air ground team idea, the concept of it, was refined greatly in Korea.
In all this close air support that you were performing, both in World War II and Korea, did you ever get hit?
Yes. I got hit five times in World War II and seven times in Korea, but most of them were single bullet holes or double bullet holes or just rifle fire. But in World War II, there was one that hit on the leading edge of the F-4U that made a spot about a little smaller than a volleyball, maybe indentation of wing. I never did know what caused it because it wasn't an explosive shell. But in Korea, I got hit several times. In Korea, I got hit seven times, but three of those were with explosive shells. And those were ones that were ones that I was just lucky that they didn't knock the airplane down. One was out on a wing that blew a hole in the wing and sprayed shrapnel all over the cockpit. And I don't know whether we're showing the F9F with a hole in the tail, which was that was one in which it was about as close as I ever came on that one, because he hit just as I was coming down to shoot up an anti-aircraft position and was just pulling out from that run, just as this anti-aircraft from across the valley apparently hit the tail of the airplane and knocked the trim out. So I had to hold a lot of pressure on the stick to come back, but it still flew okay. But so yeah, there were three major hits in Korea and only one in one that could have been considered big in World War II. But a lot of planes get those single holes. We had that happen quite often. But the ones in Korea, the big ones that were explosive shells, those were a little different.
You had a famous wingman while you were in Korea, I believe.
Yeah, Ted Williams. And you all know who Ted Williams was. Well, at that time they had a lot of recalled reservists, of which Ted was one. And he had been trained in World War II, right at the end of the war, and never got to combat. And he was back in baseball again. Well, then he had stayed in the reserve, and he was reactivated for Korea in the reserve. And they had a policy that a regular Marine pilot, which I was, would be teamed up with a recalled reservist to sort of make a pair. And we went out just about the same time. I went out about a week after he did. But we were assigned then to each other. And it didn't mean you flew every flight together, but if you were on the flight schedule for a particular day, and on the same schedule, well, you flew together. And so probably half the missions Ted flew in Korea, he flew as my wingman, so I got to know Ted pretty well. He was a good pilot, and he didn't expect any special treatment, and he didn't get any special treatment. And he was in there for his assignments. On about his second mission, I wasn't with him on this particular one, but on about his second mission or third, he was hit by anti-aircraft fire. And the flame was coming out the back from around the engine in the Panther, and the Panther had an engine that had a centrifugal flow engine in it that was particularly susceptible to damage. It would blow up and blow the tail off the airplane. There had been some that had happened a couple of times. Ted came back and he was streaming fire and smoke, and they were calling to him on the radio to get out to eject. But the radio was out. It had been knocked out in this anti-aircraft hit he had taken. He came back, couldn't get the landing gear down, and couldn't get the flaps down. And so when he finally got back he didn't get back to our home base. He came back down to a base just below Seoul, right at Seoul, and finally came around and bellied the airplane in and slid up the runway a couple thousand feet and jumped out and ran out and watched as the fireman tried to put the fire out. So that's about as close as you can come. If you think about sitting in the cockpit of an airplane, you have the canopy bow right here ahead of you like this, right over the instrument panel. And the ejection seat you're sitting in is going to eject you straight out up this way. And Ted told me later the reason he didn't want to get out, he'd heard about some Navy pilot a short time before that who had ejected and his feet had hit the canopy and cut his feet off as he was being ejected. And Ted said he didn't want to take a chance on that, and so he'd rather ride this thing in and take a chance on it than eject. And so that was his rationale. He was very, very lucky because the thing normally would have blown up and he would have gone up with it. So he had a close one there. So he was a good combat pilot, I went on R&R to Japan with him once for a week, and we had a great time. No comment.
No comment, okay. You finally achieved your goal of being assigned to the Air Force in the F-86s up north, and you want to. They had a particular name for you, and that they painted on your airplane, MIG Mad Marine.
Yeah, well,
there must be a story that goes with that one.
Well, the story is this: you know, in the Air Force liked to name their airplanes. The Marine Corps and Navy didn't really do that. But the Air Force liked to assign a pilot to a particular plane, and so he got to name that, and that was sort of a custom. And so I had my airplane, the LAD, L-A-D, stood for Lynn, Annie, and Dave, which were my wife and son and daughters. And then we were up there, and this was getting toward the end of the war. There were rumors that peace talks might take place, and I thought the war was going to end before I ever had a chance to even get any experience in air-to-air combat. And so I was griping and moaning, I guess, a little too much. And one day I came down to the squadron, and they had painted that MIG Mad Marine on there for all this. And my initial reaction was to have it taken off, and then I was like, what the heck, I'll just fly it that way, and did. And so I took a lot of ribbing because of that. But anyway, the air-to-air flying was completely different, and that was the idea, was to get some Marine pilots with experience in air-to-air. So if Marines ever needed that, we'd have a few people that were experienced. And we'd had Jack Bolt up there ahead of time. He had gotten five. He became an ace up there. He had five MIGs he had shot down. And this was getting to be fairly late in the war. You went through a progression of things. You not only had a check, you went through checkout missions, but you also went then worked your way up. You started out as a wingman, and then you worked your way up to maybe being an element leader with your two planes. And then after a while, after you got more experience, then you became a flight element leader or flight leader. And those were the shooting positions. Those were the ones where if you got into a scrap, the people in those lead positions are the ones that usually were the ones getting airplanes or getting MIGs. I did my checkout missions up there, and then had the on one of the checkout missions, I was flying with our squadron CEO, and they had said that if the MIGs were not flying at a particular time, to save our fuel and ammunition and go down low, if there were just no MIGs in the air that day, and come down long roads and try and catch trucks and things like that on the road and shoot those up. John Girardo was my skipper up there. He was an Air Force major. He was flying his wing. We were down low and had some trucks on the road, and he was shooting at them. I was right behind him, and he got hit by anti-aircraft fire and knocked out his elevator, and the plane was going up and down in big swings like this. He couldn't control it, and he finally had to get out. And he was down on the ground, and I could see it was sort of a little scrub oak area or scrub tree area, but I knew he was all right because I could see the chute being pulled in. He was going to pull in and hide it, which he did. And I called for the helicopters to come up from an island offshore, Chodo Island, and they radioed back they were on the way. They never got there, but I stayed as long as I could, and until there was just enough fuel to get back to altitude and glide over our lines, and did stick back into K-13, which was our field. So it was the only no-power dead stick landing I ever had, and it was about the way we calculated, it was about a 108-mile glide getting back. John then, I kept up there and kept circling over the spot he was, he'd gone down. And at the end of the war, when they announced the prisoner swap, Big Switch it was called, you may recall, John was not on the list. And then a couple of days before the end of the Big Switch was to occur, his name was on one of the lists that came out. Well, Tom Miller, my good friend, meanwhile had been assigned by the 1st Marine Air Wing to be the Marine liaison up there to take care of any Marine people that were coming out on the POW release. And so Tom knew about, he saw John Girardo's name, and we talked, and so he made me an assistant And I was up there then when John came out. And John, he was laughing, but when the first time we saw each other, he faked as though he was being very mad at me and was giving me the devil. And I, what's wrong with you? And so he laughed and he said, what had happened was, every time I came around down on the ground where he was, it was a bad scene for him for this reason. They had had some people come up from a little village and were coming up to where he had come down these parachute, and he had pulled his chute in and was trying to get away, and these people were coming up toward him, and so he was crawling away, and the dinghy that was part of his parachute just blew up on its own and made a big hissing sound, like that. And so the people knew where to come to find him. And there was a soldier with him, and the soldier, when John stood up, the soldier fired, and one slug went through his shoulder and out the back. And he said, then they marched him off through this underbrush, and every time I'd come over, they'd throw him in the ditch and sit on him. He said, it hurt like hell. All he wanted me to do was go home. But we had a great reunion anyway, and so John later on was legislative liaison from the Air Force to the Senate over here. So anyway, long
but
story.
We need to move on to Pax River, but before we go, I'd like to just emphasize, the Senator just calmly or very casually mentioned that he glided 120 miles in dead sticks to swept wing jet to into an 8,000 foot runway that was not his home base. That's not your average day of flying. Yeah.
It was just 108.
Oh, 108. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. But and just to set the record right, today it's prohibited for a pilot to make a dead stick landing in a swept wing jet. So it's dangerous. So that was a that set you up for this test pilot school that you were about to go to, I guess.
Well, we had practiced some of this, and as you cut back on the power and put the speed brake out just a little, and then make a circle and see exactly how much altitude you lose in that circle. So you knew exactly how to, when the airplane was empty, you knew exactly how, if you got back to over the field with any altitude left, well, you thought you could make it in, and did. So.
You had a tailwind that day too, right?
Yeah, I did. Yeah, yes.
All right, we need to go now to Pax River.
Pax River, I came back from out there and had applied for test pilot training and did, and got it. And so I was on test pilot duty for about the next 3.5 years, including the time in school. And that was a great time to be a test pilot because we had a lot of our new high performance attack and fighter aircraft that were like the F-4D, a fighter that was made by Douglas at that time, a sort of a planned form of a Delta wing. We had the FJ-3, which was the Navy and Marine Corps version of the F-86 that I'd been flying in Korea. We had the F-7U Cutlass, which is sort of a praying mantis type looking airplane, and some new versions then of the F-4U, which were still being improved at that time. I was in armament test, and that was a great place to be too, because we were supposed to load up the airplane with all the ordnance, just like you would have it if you were going into combat, and then go up and go through maneuvers to fill out the envelope, as it's called, on different G levels and altitude levels and speed levels, and see if what equipment worked and what equipment did not work. Machine guns, for instance, if you put 4-5G turn on, which is a fairly solid turn, would the gun still fire? They'll always slow down some, but would they hang up and actually cease to fire? And there are some problems with things like that. So those are the things you're trying to work out. All aerodynamicists and all the people that design the airplanes do the best job they can, of course. But some of these things just require being used in the combat situation that you're simulated combat position you're in order to know whether they're really going to work in combat or not. And that was our job, was to do that in armament test, which is the place that I was assigned to. There are a lot of one of the planes that I flew there that I liked the very best was the F-8U Crusader, and I don't know whether they have that picture up here yet or not.
And that'd be a good time to go into Project Bullet.
Oops, tilt, okay. The F-82 was a supersonic fighter, and it was one we had, that I'd been the project officer on at Patuxent, and had worked out some bugs on the airplane that were really serious deficiencies and that were things that would have prevented from being a good fighter in the fleet if we had not corrected them. But then after at the end of my test days there, as Jack talking about, one of the things we wanted to do with that airplane was one of the things that Pratt & Whitney wanted to do, which made this engine also, the J-57. One of the things that they wanted to do was have some sustained high power time on the airplane. And that was too good to miss. Because back in those days, there was still a lot of competition between the services, and there was some credibility, or it was, you tried to set speed records or altitude records or time to climb records, things like this that got a lot more credibility and a lot more attention back in those days than they do now. But anyway, the idea came up that I might be able to do this sustained high engine run in, and at the same time break the cross-country speed record from Los Angeles to New York. And I know he's going to call it a snivel again, so we set this project up and got it approved in the Bureau of Aeronautics, which is no longer in existence. And of course, I volunteered to be the pilot on this since I'd come up with the idea, and it was approved. So we had that as we made a crossing that required three in-flight refuelings was the plan. The Air Force had jet tankers at that time, which could stay up there at 30 or 35,000 feet, 40,000 feet, something like that. And they had tankers would sit up there. The Navy and Marine Corps did not have that. The best tanker that the Navy had or Marine Corps had at that time was the old AJ, which could only, with a full load of fuel on, could only get up to about 25,000 feet. Well, now, if you're going to make a cross-country run, at the end of each one of these legs, you're up about 50, 51,000 feet. So you had to come back down and rendezvous and refuel and then go into afterburner and start all over again. The idea, I wrote to the, we wrote a letter to the Air Force requesting jet tankers. And you can imagine what the response was on that. It was very straightforward, just said that the operational commitments prevented them from giving us any airplanes. So we had to do it with the AJ tanker, and then we still broke the record.
Did the letter say, would you let us have a tanker so we can break the speed record for coast to coast?
I think we probably did. One thing happened in that I think you'd get a kick out of, though. The last refueling was over Indianapolis, and the intended landing airport was Floyd Bennett in New York, which is no longer open. From Indianapolis, where I was to refuel, straight across to Floyd Bennett Field, went about 4 or 5 miles just north of my hometown of New Concord, Ohio. And I had called Mother in New Concord the night before and told her that approximate time I'd be by there. Well, it turned out that unknown to me, in the eastern half of the U.S., the conditions for a sonic boom reaching the ground were perfect. Now, normally you have different layers of air and clouds and it sort of mushes out and sonic booms won't reach the ground. If they do, they don't make any difference. On this particular day, there was a perfect lapse rate right down to the ground, no clouds or anything else. But when I was climbing back up then, this would be about maybe 40,000 feet and doing, I suppose, 1.3 Mach or something like that. Unknown to me, I was dragging a boom behind me that got down to the ground and was making this sonic boom right on across country following me. And many of you have heard of sonic boom, you know, boom, boom, like that. Well, Mother had told some of the neighbors about that I was going to be coming by at about a certain time. And so this woman that lived up the street a little ways from us, I went by, and apparently she heard this boom, boom on the ground. And she came running down, "Oh, Mrs. Glenn, Johnny dropped a bomb, Johnny dropped a bomb." Anyway, we broke that record. It was 3 hours, 23 minutes, 8.4 seconds. Just happened to remember that.
Yeah. Well, and that tour is what set you up to be an astronaut. It got you all the ticket punches that you had to have with test pilot, jet time.
I expect it didn't hurt anyway. I applied for that. The astronaut program was coming up, was announced just as I was coming off test duty and being reassigned. And I applied for it and went through all the tests and everything. There were all sorts of things. Physical tests, you couldn't be taller than 5'11", for instance. And if any of you looked at the Friendship 7 out there in the main hall, or which direction of the main hall, this way, I guess, you see why they had a limitation on height of 5'11". Good physical conditions, psychological testing, gave us testing backgrounds in all sorts of things, and tests in heat tolerability, sound, centrifuge, isolation, so on. Psychological testing was interesting in that, I'll tell you a story about Pete Conrad. You may remember Pete later was on the, landed on the moon. And Pete was one of these sort of ebullient, very pleasant boy, always a joke, always some characters, and a lot of fun to be with. And Pete was being considered in that first group. And he had been through a couple of these tests before, and he walked in for one of the psychologists who was going to give him another interview, and sat down at the desk, and the psychologist, or psychiatrist, I guess it was, slid a plain piece of white paper across to Pete and said, "Look at that and tell me what you see." And Pete never batted an eye. He turned the thing around like this and slid it back across and said, "Well, the first thing I see is you have it upside down."
He didn't make it in that class.
That's right. That's exactly right. He didn't make it in that first group. In the second group of astronauts that was selected some months later, well, he finally did make it and wound up going to the moon. So anyway, Pete made it, but I always thought that was humorous.
We're just about out of, in fact, we are out of time, but do you have some thoughts about the future for marine aviation specifically, or aviation in general, and that you'd like to share?
Oh, there's so many things. I think we'll continue to need a ready force. I don't think there's any doubt about that. Someone could be called on where the all elements of supporting arms are there, such as in the Marine Corps. Capable of close support, you're close to, capable of air superiority if necessary. You are for limited warfare. This isn't supposed to be a force that can take on all of World War II, for instance, or huge battle areas. It's for limited warfare. And key to it is time. It has to be immediately usable. I remember one of the first squadrons I was in, there were some crates over in the corner. I asked what they were. They were our field kitchen, ready to go right then, ready to go. And that's what makes the Marine Corps particularly valuable. And the air assets, the air ground team particularly valuable, is all elements of supporting arms go. It's one-stop shopping if a president wants to call for someone to go someplace and do something, if he needs that that kind of military force. I don't think any of us really foresee a huge land war like we used to think about in Europe, with the divisions and tanks pouring through the Fulda Gap and taking over all of Europe. I don't think that's likely, but the threat has changed a great deal. Wars and conflicts used to be fought government to government, and now we're up against smaller non-government forces. Non-government forces aren't even controllable, maybe by the country in which they're located. They can be as big a threat as we know from 9/11 and what happened in New York. And yet, Al-Qaeda, with all of its threat in Afghanistan, if they get pressed there, they set up a headquarters in Yemen or Sudan and start operations across the border. They're not subject to our normal warfare, government to government thoughts the way it's been in the past. Or even the bandit type operations like in Somalia now. These are not something where you're going to start a whole world war over. But there are things that we have to be concerned about since it's involving international shipping and some of our ships. At the same time, this new equipment has changed warfare and changed close support and changed the air ground, is changing the air ground team. That's already changed to some extent. And back through some years ago, General Dailey and my good friend Tom Miller were both involved with what the Marine Corps called vertical envelopment. Means going to much more use of helicopters and being able to shuffle people around. That now is transferring over to the Osprey to some extent, which is capable of carrying twice as many people, twice as far and twice as fast as the helicopters do. You have the joint strike, there was something I was forgetting, the Osprey and the joint strike fighter, the F-35, which will replace not only the old Harrier, which was a jump jet, which it was part of this vertical envelopment program, and could operate off a road, didn't need a runway, can operate off a road, or can be, so it can operate much more closely to the lines where they're needed, so they can be on target to be supporting the people on the ground in a matter of minutes instead of a half hour or 40 minute wait while you call back someplace. So this vertical envelopment idea is something that has changed the Marine Corps and is changing it even further. In the new equipment that's changing it also, you think back, the tactics that we used from World War I through Vietnam were basically the same. You put a gun on an airplane, you try and get out there and get on the tail of another plane, shoot it down, and that's been the same since the Lafayette Escadrille or people in Korea or in Vietnam were doing. And so the tactics basically remained the same. Gunnery was sort of a fixed thing. Bombing, sort of the same thing. You went out and you had a fixed bomb site and you made your dive bombing runs and you dropped the little practice 2-pound mini bombs with a smoke puff that shows where it hits. And we dropped hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of those, practicing and practicing. Well, what's happened now with the new equipment? Well, the new equipment means that I'm sure most of you saw the movie Top Gun back when it came out a decade or almost 15 years ago now, I guess. And maybe it was a little bit theoretical at the time, but this is for real now for sure. And that is, you see something on the radar scope out here, and if it's identified as an enemy, you can fire a missile, the missile will go out, shoot the airplane down, and it goes off the radar scope. You've had a kill, you've had you've shot an airplane down and never saw it. And that kind of thing is not, in modern day warfare, that would not be unusual. It'd be very, very common. And think of all the time we spent down there doing close air support and bombing and training for bombing and training and flight after flight after flight doing this. Now with GPS, you come in 15 or 20,000 feet, miles away from target, release a bomb, it's released down there and follows its track, and you literally you can literally decide whether you want to come against that wall or that wall. And that is not even as accurate as, I mean, it's more accurate than that. And so this is changing warfare tremendously. And even beyond that, we're now going to drones, where pilotless drones, where they're controlled on the ground. And the Marine Corps is very much involved with some of that activity also. So aviation is changing rather directly. But even in this new situation that we're in with all of this, it seems to me that the way you finally control a certain area, which I think our people will still have to do, I mean, you still have to have boots on the ground to control it. And you still need a balanced force to establish and maintain that kind of control. War should be a last resort. It's tough, and it's brutal, and it's fatal. It's not all flags flying and bands playing as we see in the movies or think about sometimes. It's a different story when you have to do as many of you have done, I'm sure also, and gather up somebody's personal effects and write a letter back to a wife or a mother someplace about what happened. And so it's, but I think much as we hate the idea that World War I didn't make the world, that wasn't the war to end all wars. We wish maybe there was a war to end all wars. But until that happens, what we better say is if there's war, we must win it. And that's the reason for all of the work on new equipment, new tactics, an air-ground team. And what Cunningham started 100 years ago that we celebrate this year as the 100th anniversary of Marine Aviation, what he started adds measurably to our nation's capability to do exactly that, to win. We don't ever want to be in second place, no matter what the war is. So,
thank you very much, Senator Glenn. We have time.
Thank you. Thank you.
We'll have a chance to do that again in just a minute. We've got time for question and answer here. So in the planetarium and out there in Milestones, get ready. We'll be with you in just a second. Do we have a question here? Yes, right here in front. Speak up, please, because we're both hard of hearing.
Hi, Senator. It's a privilege to meet you. I would be interested in hearing you describe the first time that you orbited the Earth in the Mercury program.
That's a one-hour lecture. How much you want on this thing? The question was, he'd like to hear him describe what it was like to orbit the Earth the first time.
Main difference is weightlessness. Obviously, that's the reason you're up there is to and you're going around you don't just open a bottle like that. You put the tube in your mouth and squeeze the tube to make the water come in. Otherwise, you got water all over the place. And you're up there to do, once you get used to this, and as we've progressed from one flight to another, we're up there to do basic research in this area. And I think that's at a time period when this country's being challenged in some of these research areas. I think it's more important than ever to have that kind of research capability. The feelings up there are two things. One is just the way you feel. It's a good feeling, but it changes your body some. Your body over the first day or so as a fluid shift, your face gets sort of fat and then your body adjusts and has less fluid in it than you had here on Earth. You have to redo that and replenish that supply before you come back to Earth again. The view from up there is something like it's unbelievable almost, because you're seeing whole countries at a time. And sometimes you can look down, see whole weather systems down there and see the patterns. But your basic reason for even having the program is to do basic research that's going to be of benefit to people right here on Earth. And that's the important part of it. And that's the reason why I supported wholeheartedly the International Space Station. And I was sorry to see the shuttle be cut back when it was cut back. But those decisions were made back in the previous administration, and so the shuttles are gone. But we're getting along now by having our people paying the Russians to take our people into space to our space station, which is a rather... Anyway, that's what we're doing. The bet was made that we should go commercial and let the companies compete. That's underway now. We just had the SpaceX just went up a couple of days ago, and we'll see how that works out. But I'll be glad when we get back to where we control our own, where we are really the world's best spacefaring nation and can do our own travel back and forth to our own spacecraft. Glad to get back to that.
Okay, in the planetarium, do you have a question? Planetarium?
No questions from the planetarium.
Okay, Milestones?
Hi, Senator Glenn. It's an honor to ask you a couple of questions.
One question, please.
Oh, okay. Well, one question. And what is the most recent or modern jet fighter you've had a chance to actually go up and fly in?
It was the F-18, I guess. When I was in the Senate, I used to get groups together, and the Navy loved this. They'd like to have us do it. When they were qualifying people aboard ship out off of Norfolk, squadrons would be requalifying. They'd be out there maybe 75 or 100 miles out, and we'd get a group together and fly out of Andrews out here and go out in what's called a COD plane, a carrier onboard delivery, big prop plane that can take 25 people or 20 or 25 people and some cargo, and has a tail hook and goes out and lands aboard. And we get this group of a dozen people or so go out. And while they were being oriented in the ship and watching the carrier qualification, I'd usually have it set up where I could in a two-place F-18, I could go up in the rear cockpit, and we'd go up and fly off the carrier a little while and back down. And yes. You got it.
I didn't say
that. I did do that. And I guess that's the highest performance plane I've flown recently. And that's a number of years back now. I've been out of the Senate now for about 12 years, so that's about 13, 14 years ago, the last flight I had in something like that.
Yes, right here.
How old were you when you realized you wanted to be a pilot? And if you were under 18, why did you choose the Marines over the Air Force or Navy?
They didn't have an Air Force back then. How old were you when you decided you wanted to be a pilot? And if you were under 18, why did you pick the Marines?
Well, I think I could look back now, and I wouldn't have said this back then, of course, but I think looking back on it, when I was about 8 years old, because my dad had talked a lot about aviation. He'd been in World War I in France and had seen some of the planes flying over there, and he was a little fascinated by aviation, and we went up the old Cleveland Air Races a couple of times, drove up from our home in Ohio. One time we were going by a field near Cambridge, Ohio, where there was a guy in an old Weco, open cockpit, two-wing plane, was taking people for rides. And so my dad and I went up, and we had one strap across both of us in the cockpit. But looking down at that time, and we didn't have much money, and I never thought I'd be able to learn to fly. But I went home and made all these little balsa wood airplanes, the kind you really used to have to put together. Cut them out and put them together yourself, not the plastic clip-togethers that the kids have now. These are ones you really worked on, and you covered them with paper, and you flew them. They were rubber band motors, and you flew them, and they'd crack up, and you'd fix them up again. And I had them hanging all over my room. So I had an interest in aviation, never thought I'd be able to fly. And then when I was, as I said before, I think when I was in college and saw this thing on the civics bulletin board one day that you could get your private pilot's license and the government would pay for it, I thought I'd died and gone to heaven. You know, that was something I couldn't miss. And my first efforts at flying were in an old Taylor craft, which was 65 horsepower, and soloed in that back in the spring of 41. And the Pearl Harbor then was in the December 41.
Okay, right here.
I've read in your memoirs up to the point where immediately after Pearl Harbor, you actually first enlisted in the Army Air Force.
Yeah.
And then after a ridiculous number of months waiting for further orders, you said, enough of this, and enlisted in the Navy. You said you worried you might hear from the Army at some point about this. Did you ever hear from the
The question was that he heard from his memoirs, it indicated that he had actually enlisted in the Army Air Force. But they took so long to call him that he went ahead and joined the Naval Aviation Cadet Program, but was concerned about whether the Army may be still looking for him.
Yeah. Well, it's true. This other fellow and I, we went over immediately, and we sort of canvassed around. They said, yeah, we could go right away, and we wanted to get going. And we didn't know all the differences at that time between what was the Army Air Corps then. The Air Force hadn't been formed yet. And So anyway, we signed up. Well, then we didn't get orders. And this went on and on, week after week. And finally, we got disgusted and went over and talked to the Navy guy. And he said, yeah, we can take care of this right away. And so we did, signed up in the Navy and were accepted. And I never went back to the Army. And so as I said in that book, I think I may be AWOL on somebody's books, but they haven't come after me yet.
Senator Glenn, we want to thank you for a great evening. And this Lindbergh lecture has a special significance in that on the 80th anniversary of Lindbergh's flight, the sculptor Don Wiegand created some bas-relief sculpture, one of Lindbergh and the other of the Spirit of St. Louis, which he donated to the museum and we have in our collection. But he has also created miniatures of those, which he has presented to us to present at this lecture each year. And the Wiegand Foundation is a partner with the Charles A. and Ann Morrow Lindbergh Foundation. So it's a partnership, and we're very proud to be able to present this to you tonight. And I want to give people a... I don't, you probably can't see it back there, but this is a magnificent medallion here that has Lindbergh on the front and the Spirit of St. Louis.
That's good. Thank you.
Appreciate
it. Thank you, Ben. Thank you.
Thank you. And once again, I'd like to thank Bombardier for making this evening possible and want to thank you for supporting our programs, and we look forward to seeing you in the future. And tonight, if you would please leave via the rear of the theater, and there'll be guides to get you down to the main floor. But thank you very much, and thank you, Senator.
Thank you.